Nuno and João are partners from the Walking Mentorship, and they bring the inside look in the life of the people they walk with. The podcast Keep Walking With Me searches for potential solutions towards the best version of ourselves. Every month, we walk together with a guest. There is a disclaimer that needs to be shared. After listening to this program, you might feel the urge to step outside and go for a long walk. But don't worry, that is absolutely normal.
Welcome to the podcast Keep Walking With Me. Today, we have another very special guest walking and talking with us. So let's get started. So I would love to ask you, in a nutshell, who is Julie Lewis?
Wow, that's a big opening question. I am Julie Lewis. I'm a British originally. I have lived in the Middle East for the last, for more than a third of my life, actually, for 26 years. I am a speaker, an explorer, and a two times author. My latest book is called Uncharted Waters, Discover Your Hidden Depth. I'm a friend, a mother, a wife, a daughter, a sister, an auntie. I'm a huge advocate for nature. And my mission is to encourage more people to spend more time in nature and listen to the wisdom. And like you guys, walking and talking in nature is one of the biggest longevity factors I can think of. You know, it's social connection and then connection to all that energy and keeping the legs strong. You know, I call my legs my taxi. When people say you want a taxi, I say, no, I have my legs. It's okay. So, yeah, is that okay for a big opening question? Who is Julie Lewis?
That's amazing.
It's great. Wonderful. Julie, actually, let's actually start exactly on your last book, Uncharted Waters, where you explore many ways water can teach us so many important lessons. So maybe you want to share with us some examples of those lessons.
Of course. You know, I had the idea for the book in 2017. I had gone back to the same mountain that I climbed for my 40th birthday. I went back for my 55th birthday to see what message it had for me, because I always get lots of messages when I'm out in nature. And it was pouring it down with rain, so the message was definitely about water. And it made me think, you know, there's a beautiful quote, stand like mountain, flow like water. And up until that point, I'd been saying, you know, you need to stand strong like a mountain, climb the mountains, be the mountain, etc. And then seeing all this water made me think, wow, water is very strong and powerful too. And it's about flow and resilience and adaptability. And the fact that water is the only element that can exist in three forms. It can be liquid, it can be solid, think of an iceberg, and it could be a vapor, it could be steam. And I thought, how cool that is. And just imagine if we as human beings could shape shift like that when we're in a hot situation, that we could become an iceberg or a snowflake and cool down. So really the idea for the book came on a mountain where it was pouring it down with rain. And I kind of got this message that I needed to spend more time in, on, around and underwater. And I'd read a book called Blue Mind by the late Dr. Wallace J. Nichols about the neuroscience of what happens when we're in, on, around or underwater. And I thought, wow. So in my ultimate wisdom and always wanting to challenge myself, I attempted to swim the English Channel from England to France. Next time I'm going to take the ferry. I didn't make it. However, I learned so much about water, about being like water. When we feel stuck, you know, water always finds a way to move. You know, when you're between a rock and a hard place, it's like, be like water, let me be water and find a little way through. So the book really came from this experience on the mountain, then the experience in the English Channel where I was swimming in the dark with a diesel boat next to me, just saying, be like water, because initially I was quite tense and I just thought, relax, be the water, become one with the water, find a way. After 4.5 hours, then the boat pilot said, sorry, you're not going to France, and you know, dragged me out for safety reasons. And then I just started thinking, you know, different bodies of water, you know, from a lake, it's stillness and silence and reflection. Lakes are like big eyes in the landscape that reflect everything. I thought of a river, you know, of resilience, you know, you imagine that twig on the river just going down towards the ocean. It's not hanging on to the side saying, no, 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 it's too big, it's scary. You know, it's just going. And then I thought about a waterfall. You know, as entrepreneurs and business people, we go over the edge. You know, we start a new business, we learn a new language, we move to a new country, we go over the edge and just trust that we're going to land. So I was drawing lots of different parallels from different bodies of water, even a puddle. You know, as kids, we would run and jump in the middle of the puddle. As adults, we kind of avoid it, thinking, no, I don't want to get wet. And it's like, what? You know, jump in the puddle. You know, the individuality of each snowflake, you know, the presence of an iceberg. And then, you know, sitting in an ice bath, you know, what can that, you know, teach us, you know, to calm? And then I looked at life below the water because, you know, we have this ecosystem below the waves as well, you know, whales, dolphins, fish, that we're all connected, interconnected. So it was, I wasn't always looking up for the mountains for answers, you know, the spirits in the sky. It was like, what about the depths of the ocean where you have huge whales that are wisdom keepers that, you know, you take them out of that ecosystem and things change. So it was really going to the depths of our being and discovering things about ourselves, that we are water, we're 70% water, the planet is 70% water. So that kind of really was a beautiful big sister to Moving Mountains, Discover the Mountain in You, my first book. And in the shower a few days ago, I already had an idea for the third book, but I thought, let this one swim around for a little while, but then we already have the idea. And of course it's linked to nature. It's about the forest and trees and about being grounded and the earth and, you know, the wildlife and an enchanted forest. So thank you for asking, because, you know, everybody used to say, Julie, mountains, mountains. And now people say, oh, you're a mermaid or you're a dolphin, something like this. And, you know, you can be both. You know, there are times when we need to stand strong like a mountain. And there are other times when we just have to let go and say, just take me wherever I need to go. Or, you know, I'm going with the flow. You know, I've become this ocean. What was that Rumi quote? You're not a drop in the ocean. You're an ocean in a drop. I mean, there's about 127 quotes in the book all about water. And it's amazing. You know, no water, no life. Remember, you are water and water always finds a way. So it's, as you say, it's an invitation for people to have love and gratitude for water, because we drink it, we are water, we wash in it, we swim in it, we, you know, we kayak on it, we dive in it, we use it for so many things. And if the minute it's gone, it's like there's no life.
Yeah,
that we breathe. And the water, when people say, what can you absolutely not live without, Julie? I go, air and water. And you go, I say, yeah, because if I can't breathe and I dehydrate, I'm not even here to have all those other things that people can't live without, you know, the house, the car, the job, the, you know, everything else. Is that air and water, that's what I need.
It's so interesting you're saying that, Julie, because actually just last week we returned from a program actually in the community Santiago, and we got a nice visit from Storm Kirk. And we got so many messages. People were very worried about the rain and so on. But actually, to be very honest, the only thing that worried us was really the wind, because when you walk in forest, that can be dangerous, and safety first. But the rain, which, by the way, followed us and walked with us pretty much every day of the week, was just amazing. And I was listening to you and thinking quite often, walking in the back of the group and seeing how people, maybe in the beginning, they were avoiding puddles and water and mud. And then through the middle of the week, they just go through. And actually, towards the end, they even enjoy. They see a puddle and they see, okay, let's go that way because we'll have so much more fun. So actually, I think it's really a matter of attitudes, first of all. And then, as Nuno likes to say, we are all waterproof, so no problem.
Scandinavians say there's no such thing as bad weather, only bad clothing. So, you know, if you've got the right gear, and at the end of the day, it's only water. When people say it's raining, it's only water.
Doesn't matter. I mean, in the end, your clothes might get wet. So what? You put them to wash and dry and you're good, good to go. You're still waterproof. You don't have any problem with that. You can survive very well in water. And actually, it's very interesting, Joan, that you mentioned that, because I was thinking, relating exactly to the same, and how even that pouring rain can actually help you to go deeper and kind of get a different insight. But I attended the presentation of your book here in Cascais in Indy, not a bookshop, and it was amazing. And I was especially impressed by the way you explained how, well, what people would generally call the failure of crossing the channel was not a failure, was actually something that you learned and took so much from. And I would really love to, if you could share with our listeners, because I found it immensely inspiring.
Yes, you know, I think I was 56 years young when I attempted the channel. The average age of a channel swimmer is 36, but I just kept thinking the water doesn't know I'm 56 for the water. It's just another body in the water. You know, it was meant to be a team relay swim, and about 3 or 4 months before the actual swim slot, four people dropped out when they realized you can't wear a wetsuit and you need to live in Dover and deal maybe for a couple of weeks because sometimes the window changes, etc. So it's a huge commitment, basically. And so I was thrown in at the deep end, really, because I'd already paid a deposit for the boat. And I thought, if these four people are not swimming with me, then the option is I find four more people, which is quite hard in 3 months to find somebody that is willing to swim in cold water for that much of time, or I give it a go myself. You know, it was a bit of a screw it, let's do it kind of scenario. That, you know, what's the worst thing that can happen? The worst thing that can happen is I don't make it. The best thing is I make it, and it's somewhere in between. So I had to swim 6 hours in cold water just to qualify to swim solo, which I did in June 2018. I then lived in a caravan in Deal, and I just swam every morning, then ate, then slept, then swam again, then ate, then slept, and it just repeats. And my coach said, if you can swim for 10 hours consistently, you will be able to see Cap Grenet, the lighthouse, and then you've only got another 5 hours to go after that. So 3 weeks before the slot, I completed a 10-hour swim, which is the longest I've ever swum in my whole life, just around Dover Harbour. I mean, like a goldfish, just swimming around, swimming around. Every hour I would swim towards a kayak, and I would have some like warm hot chocolate, or I'd have a jelly baby, or sometimes magnesium spray because I was starting to cramp up. And I thought, okay, I've got this, you know. My swim was scheduled to start at midnight. I'm an early bird. I normally go to bed at 9:30 and I wake up at 5. I said, please, can I start at 4 in the morning or 3 in the morning, but not midnight because that's my peak sleep time. It wasn't possible. Anyway, so, you know, you can't say, no, I want to go at this time and I want to take this route. You know, it's just like you just go when the boat pilot says. So it was overcoming a huge fear for me, really. I'd done 3 or 4 training swims at night, but swimming in the night in the English Channel that is full of lots of things, not so nice things either. You know, it's not exactly the cleanest water on the planet, and it's one of the busiest shipping lines, you know. So the smell of the diesel boat, and then the, you know, where am I aligned to the boat, you know, stay away so I don't get sucked under the boat, but not so far that I have to swim back to get a feed. So I had a lot of things going on in my head, and I had a playlist in my head. A song for every mile that I was going to swim. I only sang 4.5 of the songs and then it was time to come out. But what it taught me was that, you know, it's okay to not complete something. It's, you know, is it my soul or is it my ego? You know, because very few people, more people have climbed Mount Everest than have swum across the English Channel. 2 out of 3 people don't make it. So I was one of those two. It wasn't my day. So I think, you know, instead of saying, you know, initially I cried because, you know, and then I just thought, why am I crying? Who am I crying for? You know, I just done something that most people will never do in their lifetime. I just connected with water on such a deep level of becoming the water and overcome some of the fears. And, you know, what can I do with this? You know, how can, you know, what have I learned? What is the gift for me in this? Mm-hmm. And it's to love and respect water, because that means loving and respecting yourself, because we're 70% water. That it was actually not failure. For me, failure is not even trying. It was to give mm-hmm. it my best shot on that day, at that time. And if it worked out, great. If it didn't, so be it. But I just learned about, you know, the strength and spirit of the human, of the mind and the body, but also to very much respect that Mother Nature always, always has the last say. Mm-hmm. She was taking me back towards the big ferry ports where the big P&O cruises. Normally you kind of go like this and then the tide changes every 6 or 8 hours and then you go with the tide movement. But it was so strong, the water was higher and faster. It was literally, and I've got quite big shoulders, you know, it was literally taking me where I didn't want to go. And life sometimes takes us places we don't want to go. And we have to decide, do I swim upstream or do I just say, okay, this is the way we're going right now. I make the best of it. And what do I learn from this? And when I get out of this flow, what have I learned from it? How can I apply it? So, you know, for me, it's to encourage people to follow their dreams, you know, train hard, play hard, give it your best shot, but and love and respect the elements and nature. And so for me, it's not a failure because the whole book came out of it, you know, so that's part of my legacy that, you know, winning is not the only thing, you know.
Absolutely. And actually, we know that you also organize expeditions. And here, definitely the will is much stronger because most likely you go where you want to go. So of all these amazing places that you visit, is there a favorite? I know it's a bit of an unfair question, but...
It is, you know, because they all, as you know, because you do this also, each journey or experience is very special because of the location, the environment, what you're seeing, hearing, feeling. I mean, it's like all your senses come alive again. You're not on this autopilot. It's like, whoa, I saw this. I can hear this. I close my eyes. I can feel that. Oh, you know, it's so energizing. And the people, because for me, people are fascinating, you know, how they respond to the environment that they're in and other people and the pace and everything. For me, observing, I lead from the back. And I love, because I know then that everybody in front of me is fine and I have a guide at the front. So I've learned something from each and every one of the 70 expedition stroke retreats I've ever run. There's one place that I've been to 10 times and people say, but why? And that's Svalbard in the Norwegian Arctic Circle. And this is a dog sledding, snow and ice climbing experience. And it's a big white desert, you know. And people say, but you live in the desert. You live in the Middle East where it's so hot. You've got sand and you've got heat. And then you go to snow and cold and polar bears instead of camels. And, you know, and you have huskies. It's the only way you can move. And it's interesting because I don't know if you've ever done those DNA tests. I did the spit into the tube and sent it off. I have 17% Scandinavian DNA. So, you know, it's part of my heritage. I also have 24% Western Europe. So I think because of the vastness and the silence that it's just you and these six huskies, that's the only way you can move. And you've just got this vastness and it's just incredible. There's no words to describe it. So that has definitely been an experience. Antarctica is definitely the opposite side, you know, where you're crossing one of the most dreaded sea passages ever, the Drake Passage. And then all of a sudden, after going through this treacherous sea, you're on this pristine wilderness and you've got thousands of these little penguins coming towards you. And it's like, what? This is wild, you know, and they haven't seen anybody for so long. So I think, you know, the top and bottom of the earth have always, you know, held a special place in my heart because they're so different. Mountains that I've climbed, you know, in my youth, you know, so much younger than I am today. When I was younger, it's a Beatles song, isn't it? And you know, going through enchanted forest, when the last time I did the Camino, we started in Bayona and we walked along the coastline and then we went through the forest. So I think it's a connection to nature and everything you see, hear and feel. So Nepal, Bhutan, Tibet have very special places in my heart. I'm what's termed, I think it's called a biophiliac. I just love nature and every living thing. I'm a certified biophiliac and thalassophil because I love the sea. And all those are the words that describe people that just get their food and their oxygen to feed their soul from being in nature and with people that also, you know, appreciating it. That's a long answer to what's your favorite place.
That's a wonderful answer with so many hints. And actually, maybe this is a great time to invite you to fill in the void of silence with your first song.
Beautiful.
I mean, if you would like to give us your, and maybe explain a little bit why that music, why that song.
You know, it's a sound creator that I've just recently connected with. His name is Lincoln Jessner, and he creates sounds with different frequencies. And, you know, we're all energy, we're all vibration, we're all frequencies and the chakras and the alignment. You know, when people talk about grounding, they're connecting to the earth's frequency, walking barefoot. And so when it popped up on my feed and I thought, oh, I really like this music. And it's tuned, this particular soundtrack, Om Star Hum, is tuned to the frequency of 528 hertz, which is the heart, you know. And I thought, oh, it's connecting to my heart, you know. And when you're in nature, 432, you know, the sound of the universe, the sound of nature, which is why we feel so comfortable in nature, because we're in our, it's in our nature. So I just like the fact that here's a guy that's creating music, a sound that takes you to a different vibrational frequency and makes you feel so good. And it's so different from anything else, you know. And I love, I call it dance walking. Sometimes when I walk and I'm listening to music, I actually kind of dance and people, what are you doing? I'm dance walking, you know, because I think when you move your body, you're moving your mind, you're moving your emotions. And music for me takes you into this portal, you know, of it can boost your mood. It can make you feel sad. It can make you cry. You know, we listen to music to change the way we think, act and feel. You know, do I want happy music? Do I want sad music? This is really happy. I think if you sit still listening to this music and a couple of the other tracks I've shared, then there's something a little bit wrong.
Well, then let's
maybe you've fallen asleep.
Well, that's a great opportunity. Let's tune in to the frequency of heart.
Om so hum. Om so hum. Om so hum. So,
it was great, truly, really amazing experience, actually. So let's continue with our conversation. You decided to live in the Middle East. I mean, in the beginning, you mentioned like a waterfall. You took the step forward and moved to the Middle East. Why did you choose the Middle East, and what attracts you there? What makes you call it home?
It's really interesting because I was 27, so just a few years ago, I moved to the Middle East. I was 27 when I first moved to the Middle East in 1989. I was the first, my background, my degree's in sports science. So my first opportunity was as a sports and fitness facility manager, recreation manager. And I'd been teaching in a college in the UK. I'd been doing my own thing, teaching exercise classes, being a fitness consultant. And my father always installed in me this, you know, he gave me a globe when I was 7 years old. Mm-hmm. And we used to play this game, spin the globe. And I'd close my eyes, spin the globe, and then say, I want to go there. I'd open my eyes and say, wow, what's there? You know, are there mountains? What do people eat? What kind of animals are there and everything? So, and then I would go and have wild dreams about that place. So very much from a young age installed in me that, you know, there's a huge wide world out there. And it's very easy to be a home girl. You know, you do your degree in your hometown, you meet your first, you know, your guy, you get married, you get a job. You say, and it was like, no, that's not my life. You know, there's a bigger world out there. So when this opportunity really popped out of the blue, one of my friends said, oh, they're looking for a recreation manager in Kuwait. Why don't you apply? And I go, where's Kuwait? You know, because I really didn't know where Kuwait was.
Well, that was before the war, so no one knew.
Yeah, exactly. And so I thought, if I go and I don't like it, I can always come back. You know, it was a 3-month probationary period. I went in August 1989, and I remember getting off the plane thinking, somebody just put a big hairdryer on me. It was so hot and so dry heat. And there was this English road, and you know, I had a white linen jacket, and I mean, very, very proper. And then I go into this very ornate 5-star hotel, and it really immersed in this different environment where my staff are all different nationalities. The members are all international expats. And I was there when Iraq invaded. So it was, I'd been there almost a year. And so that was my first real sense of, oh my gosh, I'm in a foreign country. All the phone lines are down. Only the British embassy know that I'm here. Iraq have invaded. I can see tanks coming. What did I do? You know, when I said this is going to be a great adventure, I didn't expect this. I'm going to shorten this up because it could be a very long conversation. At 3 weeks into the Gulf crisis, a bunch of us escaped in the middle of the night. We crossed the desert, got stopped by soldiers. Eventually, we got to the border. I was taken to a refugee camp because I was married. Married women, unmarried women, not allowed to stay in hotels, etc. I finally managed to get to the British Embassy in Riyadh. Phoned my parents, said, "Please send me some money. I need to come home. I want to come home." So I went back home. After liberation, I did go back to Kuwait. And then I came back and I had 4 years in the UK. My parents, my whole family saying, please just stay here. We want you to be safe and everything. So I stayed until 1994 and then I went back to Kuwait. Then I moved across to Dubai, which was much more liberal. Women in sport was very, very, you know, it was normal. And so I think this attraction to the Middle East, this melting pot of cultures, of nationalities, of you know, landscape, desert, mountain, ocean, mangroves, wadis, and the history and everything was really intriguing for me. And it's in the middle. So it's easy to get to Europe. It's easy to get to Asia. It's just easy. And I've stayed here ever since, really. I mean, I had a couple of years in Hong Kong when my husband was transferred to Hong Kong. We lived in Hong Kong for 2 years and everybody said, that's much better for you. It's a gateway to adventure and everything. So I think it's, you know, I think maybe if I stayed here all of the time, it might be a different story. June, July, August, it's so hot, it's so humid. That's when I kind of say, okay, I'm taking trips, I'm leading groups, I'm out. So there are kind of a good 6 to 8 months that it's really, really a good place and base. And because there's 85% of the population are expatriates. You know, 15% of those are Western expatriates. But for me, when I go into a restaurant or when in even the community that I live here, there's 10 different nationalities sat around mm-hmm. the table. And for me, that's very exciting. You know, we've all got stories to share. And just by the fact that we're expatriates, it means that we've kind of got a spirit of adventure because we're willing to dip our toes into new cultures, new food, new everything, really. So it suits me where I'm at right now. Is it forever? No. But it's a great place to bop in and out of. You know, as you know, I've been to Portugal now 5 times in the last 2 years. So there's something there that's calling me. Not quite sure what. So I think, oh, I'll spend 3 months there next year. You know, I spent 40 days there. And again, you know, it's just the friendliness of the people, the, you know, travel, the stories. I think coastal locations are always more open because they've had mm-hmm. so many people coming in and out of the port that they've had, you know, they've been exposed to more than people that are living up in the hills, for example. Mm-hmm. That's my theory. But, you know, home is where the heart is, isn't it? And you make the best of a place, mm-hmm. is it roomy, wherever you plant your heart or plant yourself, bloom there. And so it just has a special place in my heart. And my niece is just moved to Dubai and she's 27, and my brother said she's just like her Auntie Julie. I remember when you left home when you were 27 and everybody thought you were nuts, and now Alicia's doing it and I'm going, it's okay, I've got her under my wings, it's okay.
Well, so, Julie, yeah, that's wonderful, because I think we can keep on the same note of, you know, talking about people, because we have something in common. Nature supports our people and team development programs. And so we would like to hear from you, or have your view, maybe insights on how do you see actually nature and in what role to actually bring people and quite often teams made of people to a different level.
Yeah, I think it's so important. You know, for me, when I talk to, you know, when I'm pitching, I say out is the new in. You know, the environmental psychologists talk about directed attention when we're looking at screens and technology. And they talk about attention restoration when we go outside mm-hmm. and we don't have air conditioning, fluorescent lights and screens. We have big picture thinking. All of a sudden it's like, you know, I'd never saw, you know, and like the beginner's mind, going into nature as if it was your first time, what do you see? What's that tree saying to you? What does that tree represent? What does that flower, what does that mountain? So there's so many parallels in nature. And I think to take people out of the normal environment, which is very comfortable and very, you know, kind of fabricated, to go out into nature that's raw, honest, beautiful, unpredictable, you know, changeable. All of a sudden, for me, we become more neurally alive because our neurons are firing very, very differently because we are seeing, hearing, smelling, even tasting if we're eating berries or figs and things like that, and just feeling so different and feeling so much energy. You know, you mentioned about pouring it down with rain. Just think of all the negative ions after a rain downpour. You know, how can something so negative be so positive? It's just like, it's that's incredible. And, you know, the insights, the aha moments, or I call them like soul taps, you know, it's like, wow, you know, what does that mean to me? You know, when people pick up, you know, leaves or rocks, what does that mean to you? How does this make you feel? You know, walking barefoot, feeling the rain on you, hugging a tree, just connecting with the land, eating fruits from the forest, looking into the eyes of, you know, wildlife, or even of each other, because we are nature, you know. Mm-hmm. And for me, it's so beautiful to see the before and after. You know, the at the end of the day, when I lead my trips, and I'm sure you must do something very similar, it's this kind of reflective practice. And we often pick out a sense and say, okay, what did everybody see today? And we go around the table with the talking stick. I saw this, I saw, and some people, I didn't see that. And they go, we were on the same path. But people see different things. What did you hear? And it's incredible, because then the next day, the person that didn't see that is like looking out for it now, becoming like, I want to see that, you know, I want to see that butterfly that you mentioned with those beautiful colors. So I think it really just really does open ourselves up to all of the wisdom and the lessons and the insights that's possible. For me, I'm much more creative when I'm outdoors. If I'm on a creative project, when I was writing the book, I used to find a place where I could sit and look in, at water. I'd go swim in the water, then I'd come and write. I'd go for a walk and I'd be talking, leaving voice notes, I'd be singing. So I just think nature, it gives life, you know, and the more that people go out into it, the more that they will love and understand it and respect it and want to take care of it. I hope that's my wish. So I think what you guys are doing, I just think it's such a beautiful concept to walk and talk, always in nature, always walking, because everybody can walk. Not everybody wants to climb a mountain or swim the channel, but we were born to walk, you know, and, yes, and definitely. You know, all the science now says that longevity, and one of the biggest factors, another one apart from social connection, are the leg muscles, you know, because this is what carries us. So walking and building that up and breathing in that, as you're just adding years to your life and life to your years.
I would say that very much, because I think and that is one of the very interesting aspects of what we do, is that when we start walking in nature for, well, a couple of hours, but then a couple of days, how time stretches, and how at the same time you do so many things, you have so many things going on, you pay attention and you connect to so many different things, but in reality time stretches, and you live so much more than if you were on the fast-paced, intensive work, digital world. And for me, it's because actually nature is our home. And we've only very recently moved away from there, so I think it's always good to go back. Well, but let me start with another unfair question. Let's hope you enjoy it. What is something that gives you hope?
I think that more and more people are becoming more conscious and aware of the importance of taking care of nature, because Mother Nature is speaking quite loudly to us now, with, you know, world events, etc. So when I see groups, organizations, children in particular, families actually taking action, doing a beach cleanup, planting trees, you know, thinking about a different kind of holiday, looking at regenerative tourism, being more active in nature, realizing that this is part of the health integrated approach to wellness. You know, you people are learning about blue zone living, you know, superfoods, wildlife. I think, you know, things like that give me hope. And, you know, I think in terms of what we do and what you do, you become a beacon of hope and light, because you're literally giving people an opportunity to connect with nature and talk about it, not just like, I've got to get there first. You know, when I see people, when I remember the first time I climbed Kilimanjaro, there was one group just ahead of us. And whenever we got into the camp, they were comparing their, you know, their speed, their distance, everything. And I just thought, it's not a race. Oh my gosh. And
you're getting it all wrong.
You know, slow, pole, slow down. You know, when I lead groups, I say, please stop everybody, close your eyes. What can you hear? What can you smell? And then we discuss that. And I say, just turn around and see how far you've come. Look up, Look, not this head down, like we're going to get first into the camp, you know. So I think nature doesn't compete. Nature collaborates. It's a worldwide web. It's all interconnected. The trees are talking to each other. The birds are sending messages and everything. So I think what gives me hope when I see groups taking action and actually making a call for nature and saying, we need to respect and take care of nature. We need to stop doing certain things. We need to change the way we live our lives, you know, so that we can live on the planet, because there is, you know, it sounds corny, but there is no planet B. This is where we are right now, and how can we love, nurture, and protect? And when children and adults understand and connect to nature, then they're much more, you protect what you love, you know. It's mm-hmm. important that we really, for me, I would love people to fall in love with trees, with the mountains, with the forest, with it, to really look at it and just think, thank you, thank you, thank you. Really, it's such a blessing. So that gives me hope, yes. You know. My niece is a singer. She's used to singing in places and everything. And we had a walk along the beach a couple of days ago when I was in Dubai, with a barefoot walk. And I was explaining, you know, when you're walking barefoot, you know, the earthing and then the water, the magnesium, natural magnesium and the water, and just floating and just being supported and things. And she was saying, this is really interesting. It made me think more about when I come to the beach, when I'm in the water, you know, what I receive from nature, and how I can actually give back to nature. So, you know, yesterday I was on a call with a potential client, and they make golf and sports wear. They recycle plastic, and they've mm-hmm. got sustainable systems. So I think more and more people are becoming conscious that we can't just keep taking, using. It's just like, stop. Mm-hmm. You know? So that gives me a lot of hope. That's a big question, but I loved it.
Well, thank you, Julie, for your answer. And actually, I guess Nuno and I couldn't resist to smile a little bit when you talk about how people are rushing. I think one of the biggest challenges in our programs at the Walking Mentorship, but I think people after one or two days, then they get it and they stop asking, because everybody asks every day, you know, about the distance, how many kilometers? And actually, we never talk about kilometers during the whole week. There's only one day we talk, which is in our farewell dinner. We share with people how many kilometers they walk, and people get so impressed, because usually they are worried about the day. And we never talk about it, because we understand it doesn't add any value to the experience. Actually, it's quite the opposite. Brings a lot of stress. But in the end, for you to understand what you achieved, actually, that adds a little something, that, you know, this sense that, wow, is it possible I walked that long? Yes, it is. Well, it was one step at a time, one day at a time. But on that note, well, what is your personal Everest, Julie?
My personal Everest, yeah, we're talking mountains now, like reaching the Chumalunga or Sagarmatha, the names of Everest, you know, mother goddess of the universe, the peak of the peaks, you know, the holder of the universe, basically. I think, you know, it's to continue growing, learning, expanding, and then being able to share that. So I think the greatest thing we can do is be of service to ourselves, take care of ourselves, learn and grow, and then share what we've learned to as many people as possible, so that it becomes a ripple effect, that we potentially make waves of change, for want of a watery term, as opposed to a mountain. So I think, you know, when we become the Everest, the mountain, that we want to actually be this strength, stability, resilience, guide, magic, mystery, all of the things that I associate with that. It's just to keep learning and growing, learn, grow, share, you know, and encourage that in others as well. So that's the kind of Everest. I mean, I could say I want to lead 40 more expeditions. I want to write 10 more books. I want to have 24 speaking engagements, all those kind of goals. But I think at the end of the day is being the best version of Julie that I can be, so that people kind of say, I don't know what she's doing, but I'd like to be like that. You know, I'd like that energy. I'd like that glow. I'd like that radiance. And what is it? And it's basically, how am I thinking, eating, moving, sleeping, hydrating, spending time in nature, building social connections, giving people an opportunity. Please come and take a look, you know, just float in the water. Just go hug that tree, you know, just listen to the birds singing. So really, really simple things.
And actually, maybe you can add one more thing, which is your second song.
Ah, yes, the second song, which is actually Mario Takes a Walk. It's by Jesse Cook, and it's a nice mix of a guitar and African drum. And I think it's just got a lot of energy. And the fact that Mario takes a walk, I think when we walk, we become the music, you know, that it's just beautiful. I enjoy it very much.
All right. Let's take a walk with Mario. Thank you for that. That was a nice, refreshing walk. And well, in our walks, in our mentoring programs, we believe that each person, each participant needs to carry his or her own backpack. And that is somehow like the metaphor of life. You decide what you carry. If you carry too much, probably you're going to be overloaded. If you carry too little, maybe you'll miss something. But somehow we believe this is a good learning experience. But we realize, and these days this seems to be quite a strong trend of how people want traveling to be easy, to be light, to be without any hurdle. There's kind of a certain entitlement, I would say. And how do you think that, well, either traveling made too easy or actually made real can have a totally different impact on how we experience that and how that transforms us?
It's an interesting question because earlier this month, I spoke in Riyadh in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia at the Kingdom Business Luxury Travel Show. And I was on a panel or a roundtable discussion about the impact of technology on travel, you know, and cross-generational, what people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s and beyond, what do they choose to do and why do they choose to do it? And I told the story. It was interesting because we were in a ballroom that was named Ibn Battuta Ballroom. If you're familiar, Ibn Battuta was a famous Moroccan traveler that left home for 29 years and traveled to 40 countries, 120,000 kilometers. And he wrote the Rihla, which is like a story of what he experienced. And there was no app for that. He wasn't on Instagram. He wasn't getting downloads. He didn't have a satellite phone. It was real time. You know, I just used maps or I asked people questions and everything. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, now because we have so much technology at our hands, you know, when I first led my trip to Everest Base Camp in 2003, I had a satellite phone, I had a camera and 16 rolls of film, and I had a video camera. And for 18 days, 18 women up to 18,000, I was recording things, staying connected. I came back, I gave back the film rolls to Mr. Kodak. 3 days later, I got them, and then I got them onto slides. And then about 2 weeks after that, I did a slideshow. Now I go, I take a picture, I go, bing. And everybody in the world sees that Julie Lewis is in Tengboche on the base camp route. So it's changed. And the technology of the clothing that we wear, you know, I mean, the Gore-Tex, the, you know, the Wickaway, the merino wool, all of these things that, you know, 20, 30, 40 years ago, we just didn't have, you know, and bookings online, you know, there's a traditional pilgrimage route where you just walk and you just knock on a door. Do you have room for me to stay tonight? Or not? Oh, we're staying at this hotel. This meal is included, and, you know, and the bus will pick us up and da, 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 da. So you have something that's really put together that everything's taken into account. And then you have the spontaneous, no, we're not going on that route. This is what the route says, but we're just going to go off the route and see what we find kind of thing and be okay with that as well. I heard something at the show, all the gear and no idea, because it was one guy that led trips. And this guy had got every single gadget, everything you could possibly think of, but really no idea, you know? And then you get people that just say, I so want to come. I don't have all the right things, but I have the main things kind of thing. We've got good hiking boots, warm socks, blah, blah. You've got the major things, but you don't have all the gadgets or the apps or the the things. So I think
you don't need those.
You don't need those. I think it's, you know, you make a decision. Do you want something that's really curated down to the last? You will have your breakfast here. You will have your snack here. You will have your lunch here. You will have your, and we're doing this, this, and this. Or do you have leave room for some spontaneity? And instead of going right, you go left, but knowing you're going to get to the same place, but you're just seeing something a little bit different, basically. And that backpack analogy that you use is so powerful because people, you know, overpack, you know, I might need this, I might need this. And as you know, when you've been traveling, a lot, you know, walking a long time, you think, I wish I could.
Absolutely.
I want to get rid of this. And when you're climbing a mountain, you just think, I just take exactly what I need, no more, no less. because it's like lighten your load. What do I really, really need? And I think your trips really make people realize, I actually don't need that much. I need very little. Yeah, and then when we come back, say, wow, I have so much. You know, you know, when I come back from trips, I go, oh my gosh, you know, a kettle, you know, all that, all of these things instead of, you know, burning, you know, boiling up water or melting ice to do your food as we do in the Arctic. So you think, oh my gosh, I'm so blessed, I'm so lucky. So I think, you know, you've got all of the extremes, you know, is it moderate, is it challenging, is it adventurous, is it extreme, is it radical? You know, I think people, you know, grade their trips and so that people have a little bit of an idea of what to expect. And I do that with my clients, you know. So the first night we're going to sleep in the desert in a goat hair tent and the toilet is wherever you want to go to the toilet. That's the toilet, you know, but at the end, this is the first time I took a group to Jordan. I said, but at the end, we're going to stay in a 5-star hotel in the Dead Sea and be covered in mud and float in the sea and then have a spa treatment. But you'll have gone through that progression of
the whole process.
In the middle of the desert, eating food that somebody's cooked in the depths of the sand. You know, that Mazied has cooked this for us. He's singing songs with his oud and you're in the middle of this desert. To in the middle of a forest, in the middle of a canyon. And then, you know, eventually you end up in this 5-star hotel with a nice meal, a glass of wine, white fluffy towels, hot showers. And then you get on a plane, you go back home. So you've had all of these experiences. And which one did you learn the most from?
Absolutely, Julie. Yeah. And I live in the countryside and I always think about some years ago, I was very eager to try new technology, gear, clothes, etc. And one of my neighbors working on the vineyards always looked at me in a kind of a funny way. What am I doing? And one day it was pouring. And he just looked at me and he said, why don't you just use an umbrella? And it was incredible because actually we sometimes see how surprised / maybe disappointed in our programs when it's raining really a lot. Me and Noon, we just take the umbrella from our backpack, a small one, and we say it's the best technology invented more than 100 years ago, and you can breathe, you will not even sweat. So yes, indeed. But there is one thing that while you are answering this last question that triggered my next question, which is for every expedition, for every adventure, in your opinion, what is actually the ultimate goal of any expedition besides maybe the endpoint, the geographical endpoint?
I usually say to my clients, enjoy the experience. You know, don't come with a ton of expectations. It's going to be like this. I'm going to, you know, see this or do this or feel this, to actually just be in the moment and be with the path, you know, I mean, walk with the path, walk with it, and actually just be open to any and all experiences, whether they're great, good, not so good, a bit scary, a bit wild and a bit random. It's just to be open to the experience. Because for me, that's what travel and nature and being outdoors, it's an experience. And we can't always curate it. You know, people like, you know, what's the program? How many kilometers are we doing? Where are we having lunch? It's just like, let it go, let it go, let it go. Just be with the path, be with yourself, and just see what comes up. You know, let all of these conditions go. And just have the experience. Of course, you know, if you're climbing Kilimanjaro, you want to get to the summit of Kilimanjaro, but there's so much obviously to learn along the way, you know. Even people that, you know, turn around, they've still had an experience. It's, for me, it's the journey of who you become as a result of taking that journey. For me, when I climbed my first mountain when I was 40, I'd never climbed a mountain before. The person I was at the beginning of the trek was very different every 100, 200, 300 meters, because I was learning and growing more about myself, mm-hmm. building my confidence, to the person at the Laban Ratta guest house, to the person that stood on the summit with everybody singing happy birthday. All of a sudden I've become like, I was born to do this. This is what I was going to do, you know, and then to kind of come back down. You come back a different person because you've experienced something different. Even if it's only one thing that just changed your perception or perspective of something, I think that's been a good trip, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, and now for a very different question. How do you hope people will describe you?
Radiant, vibrant, enthusiastic, loving, kind, wild, nature loving, and I think just a beautiful human being, you know, that is just on a mission to encourage more people to spend time in nature and with themselves and with wildlife, and just really, really connect at a very, very different level away from this kind of dopamine. Mm-hmm. Bing, 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 bing. It's like, something needs me, instead of like, oh, did you hear that bird? Oh my gosh, look at that tree over there. Look at the colors. You know, so we have to, you know, we have the best of both worlds. Of course we do. We can't. Yeah. We're on a forest trail for our lives. So they're contrast to clarity, aren't they? It's almost like the antidote to modern day living is go into mm-hmm. nature and then reset and then come back and everything else through mm-hmm. smoothly. So, it made me think, actually, many, many years ago, I was on a program, and one of the exercises we had to do was to write our own eulogy. And they had the music.
That stuff.
From Braveheart, and you had to literally close your eyes and visualize that, you know, you were in your grave or you mm-hmm. know, and that the people are around you, who would say what. And wow, that really made you think about, how am I living my life in such a way mm-hmm. that's what people would say, you know. Here lies Julie Lewis, a mad woman, made a difference, you know, exploring, took people on wild adventures, you know, a community, all of those things. So then when you mm-hmm. come to, you know, each morning, I ask myself, is what I'm doing the best use of my time and energy? Is the behavior, the things that I'm doing, mm-hmm. are they moving me away from or towards my goal? To that eulogy that I still have in an envelope with rose petals inside. And if I'm ever feeling off track, I just go and open it. And it's kind of linked into a book, which I was given, easily 15, 20 years ago. And I thought, what a strange book to give me for my birthday. And the title was, Who Will Cry When You Die? Mm-hmm. I thought, it's my birthday. Why are you giving me a book? But then I got it. It's a Sanskrit saying that when we come into this life, we come out crying and everybody mm-hmm. else is rejoicing. Mm-hmm. And we're naked and we have nothing and we're crying and everybody else is so happy. Mm-hmm. So live your life in such a way that when it's your time to transition to the next adventure, that you are laughing and smiling because you've had a full and fulfilling life. And the people that are around you are the ones that are crying because I'm getting all emotional. But it is, it's a very powerful question. Who will cry when you die? Mm-hmm. How am I making an impact in the community? Every mm-hmm. single one of the people that were on your Camino this last week, you have impacted them. Mm-hmm. You know, if something happened to you tomorrow, God forbid it won't, it isn't, then that person would have something to say about you. Nuno or Yao made me feel like this. They showed me something that I'd never seen before or I'd never felt before. So when we live our lives in that way, you know, that big, big question, who will cry when I die? Mm-hmm. It's like, whoa, quite a few people actually. You know, and I want to go you know, having, you know, I've lived a full life. I've lived a full and fulfilling life. My legs are tired, my arms are tired, everything's shot because I've just been using it to the full, to the maximum. I said what I wanted to say. I, you know, lived a full life. And so I'm happy to go on to what's next, you know, the next adventure. Yeah. I think that's something that is quite an interesting game changer when we think like that, because, you know.
So, well, absolutely wonderful, Julie. And I think the cherry on top of the cake, I guess it will be your third song.
The third song is created and performed by my niece, Alicia. Mm-hmm. And she's my spirit daughter. I don't have children, but she's my spirit daughter. It's my brother's daughter. And I remember holding her and just thinking, oh, this beautiful, gorgeous spirit and soul. And I just knew that it was something special. And I know you're not meant to have favorite nieces or nephews, but she's my favorite. And, you know, I've seen her grow and develop from, you know, from being quite shy, quite an anxious person, and not really fitting in at school and being very different, which I think I was too. And then, you know, completing a degree in music, and then having the courage to say, everybody's saying, get a job, get a job, get a job. And I want to sing. That is a job. I'm an artist. I'm a creator. So for me to say to her, this is the book, have a read through it, come up with some music for it. And whatever you choose, I'm going to love it. You know, so giving somebody creative freedom. And so she created the song that we're about to hear. And, you know, it's that I am bold, courageous, you know, healthy. I mean, it's just like that, giving yourself permission to be what you want to be, and, you know, go and explore and be resilient and keep going, keep flowing, keep growing. And, you know, for me, and I had tears when I listened to it for the first time. I thought, that's my baby. That's my girl kind of thing. And so we created a book trailer with it. So I think it's very important that, you know, we have those special moments that are created. So it's pure joy. For me, it's pure joy to listen to this song. And I always start moving and I think, yes, keep going, keep growing, keep flowing.
And let's listen to it and enjoy. sharing your niece with us. And I'm sure she will continue on her beautiful creative journey. Which, by the way, take us to the next question, because if you could take off on any adventure today, so no constraints,
yes,
resources, whatever, what would it be and why?
Oh, do you know something? Having spoken in the Ibn Battuta ballroom in Riyadh a few weeks ago, I thought, what would a modern day Ibn Battuta person look like? If I was to go away now for 29 years, I would be 91 when I came back. Where would I go? What would I do? How would I do it? So I'm kind of thinking of things that, places and spaces, like going to Kazakhstan tomorrow. I've never been to Kazakhstan. I haven't been to any of the stands. The lands are calling me, Iceland, Finland, Lapland, Greenland. So places that not many people would go to, you know, it's not, you know, they're a little bit off the beaten track. So for me, it's just actually, I have a globe. It's just looking at it and closing my eyes like we did with my father many, many years ago and say, I'd like to go there. And then just being like surprised, like the last time I did that, I was in the Azores. I was in, you know, I was like, oh, I've never been to there. I've been to Lisbon, I've been to but just across the water, there's these magical islands that have whales and dolphins and Pico and San Miguel and all of these places. So I think, you know, there's lots to choose from, and I plan to be around for at least another 40 years. So, I'm kind of thinking, yeah, what would the modern Ibn Battuta, the female version, be like, and where would she go and what would she do? Okay. I'll keep you posted.
Please.
Yeah, please do. Please do. Well, let's say now that you have a magic wand, where you can actually do whatever you want, and you could actually add something to human beings, a feature, a skill, whatever you would like to add to human beings, to the human species, what would that be? Are we missing something as humans that you would like to fix?
I think joy is a beautiful emotion and feeling that comes up quite high on the emotional vibrational frequency, to actually do what brings you joy. Because for me, what brings me joy gives me energy. And that could be singing, dancing, writing, painting. It could be anything, but to actually infuse the world with joy and peace, of course, because of what's currently happening in the world, and that heightened consciousness about nature, really, so that we're all interconnected, that we're all interconnected. We're not apart from nature. We are nature. So what we do to the planet, we're doing to ourselves. So I think just I'm using my hands like this because it's almost like a globe and a matrix that we're all connected either by oceans or by forests or, you know, family or something like that, to actually just have this consciousness around the planet and the human race of being joyful and peaceful and loving and kind and respectful of the fact that what we do to each other or what we do to the planet, we're actually doing to ourselves.
Thank you, Julie. Well, we are approaching unfortunately, I would say, the end of this conversation. We have just a couple of questions, and the next one, I love it, and we give few options for you to answer so we don't get anyone in trouble. You know, tell us about a special place in your life. So you don't need to tell us the name, so next vacation we don't have there 10,000 people. But can you please describe it in detail to us, that special place in your life?
Wow. I count myself very blessed because I'm downloading the files in my memory now. and there are
quite a few to choose.
A lot to choose from, because I often have this, what I call a spaceship view, where I know where I am. I'm very present. But then I go way, way above myself. And I see where I am in the globe, in the world. And I remember one time, I think it was 2008 or 2009, I was at 78 degrees north in the Norwegian Arctic Circle with a small group of people and my huskies. And I just parked the huskies and we were having lunch al fresco, you know, in the field. And I remember just sitting down on this reindeer skin in this big Arctic suit with the big Arctic boots and just exactly doing that big helicopter view and just realizing I was this tiny, tiny blip, this tiny black speckle at the top of the earth, depending which way you look at it and where, you know, which perception of the earth. And I had tears coming down my eyes and I just thought, what is this triggering? Why? And it was just feeling so, so small, and any problems or things that I thought I was dealing with, they just kind of, I'd got this big zoomed out that they weren't issues at all, actually. That I was in this vast open space. All I could hear was the of the dogs, you know, calming down, and you know, and I just felt really as if I'd stood still in time. I was in a time warp in my own little world, and just feeling very, very blessed. That was definitely one occasion. Another one that's just kind of popped into my mind is having done the Inca Trail. And then going up what they call the Gringo Killer, because it's quite steep steps to the Sun Gate, and looking at Machu Picchu. And I'd had pictures of it on my vision board, because I have vision boards. And again, I had that moment, you know, with tears coming down, I'm here. And this lost, it was lost for so many years. And now it has this energy. And I walked here. I didn't, you know, take the bus or get choppered in or anything. I've actually been on this journey, and now I'm standing in the footsteps of people that stood here thousands of years ago, seeing what they saw. But, and so then, oof, I have another, like, emotional, I think I'm, you know, people say, Julie, you're so emotional. And it's they're tears of joy, they're tears of pride, they're tears of relief when I've made it somewhere. And I think, oh my God. You know, so I just think that raw, honest beauty of nature, of special places, of sacred places that have myths and legends and stories. And you think of the people that have walked there before or sailed there before or sat there before. For me, that is just very, very special. Very, very special. So that's two, but I mean, there's many others when I can, you know, for example, when we've done dragon boat races or snake boat races and we've come to the end, and then we just get off the boat and we're just huddling and hugging each other, and we've just been in this highly state of, you know, rah, 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 and we're so, it's like you can feel the pulse of it and you think, wow, what just happened? You know, so I'm blessed. I'm very, very blessed. Yeah.
That's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for sharing, Julie.
Well, and being so blessed, we kind of want you to share a blessing. So let's imagine you have a time capsule where you can place anything inside and shoot it out into the universe. And maybe tomorrow, maybe in a million years, someone or some entity will find your time capsule. What would you like to place inside?
I love you.
That's a perfect answer. Straight to the point.
Yeah, it just came straight in, you know, because that's the heart of the matter, isn't it? You know, when we're in different places, we talk about the heartbeat, the pulse of the forest, the breathing it all in, and what makes our heart beat. And it's love of something or somebody or something. So, I, you know, when you get a message that says, thank you, I love you, I just think that's beautiful.
Always resonates. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, Julie, thank you so much for this beautiful walk and talk that we just had. It's been absolutely inspiring and a great joy actually, to experience. We do wish, do hope we will walk together someday. So
That would
whenever
be
you're in
wonderful.
Portugal,
Yes.
let us know. And if we are by the Middle East, we will do the same. It has really been a great pleasure to enjoy this walk.
Indeed. Thank you, Julie, for all your generosity and for your life.
Thank you.
Keep Walking With Me. It is a podcast inspired by the walking mentorship experience. Step by step, we walk together towards the best version of ourselves. For more information about our mentoring programs, visit our website, walkingmentorship.com.